James and Rebecca, a couple living on a small homestead where we are pursuing our higher ideals through living a more natural lifestyle, raising our 6 kids, and seeking wisdom. So, James, what's new with the homestead?
Well, today, I wanted to talk about water. Where I live, it's starting to get hot. The kind of hot where you sweat standing still. In fact, there are places on the property where the ground is starting to dry out and crack. This has motivated me to move forward with my plans to install an automated watering system for my fruit trees. And that's what I wanted to talk about today. For the past 2 years, we've had to replace a number of our fruit trees that have died. Now, anytime you plant a lot of fruit trees, a certain number of them aren't going to make it. The young trees can get stressed and die for any number of reasons. Pests, disease, soil issues. Yet, the most pressing issue where I live is the hot sun. The sun burns the trees up and dries out the soil. Now, I've tried to overcome the effects of this excessive sunlight on my young trees with regular watering. But this has its limitations. The most pressing being that if something prevents me from watering for too long, the trees burn up and die. So the solution I'm working for is something more automatic, something that is not completely dependent on my fallible memory. So on our homestead, we have an aerobic septic tank. This means that our wastewater flows into a large, multi-chambered tank. Bacteria in the water breaks down whatever's in the water and purifies it over time. Yep, purifies, I don't know. Purify seems like too strong of a word because the water is never really pure. But this cleaned or processed water is then pumped from the large tank out to 3 sprinklers in our field automatically. So much water passes through this system that even at the height of summer, there's aquatic plants that grow out in our pasture near these sprinkler heads. This always seemed like such a waste. So much of the property could use this excess water when it gets really dry. It's unfortunate to have areas of excess water at times when other areas have a deficit of water. But then I saw a YouTube video from a homesteader out in New Zealand who uses his wastewater from his aerobic septic system to water his food forest. That's it. That's what I needed to do. So a few weeks back, I dug down and tapped into the PVC pipe that ran from our septic tank out to the sprinklers. I installed a couple valves that would allow me to divert the flow of this wastewater, and a manifold that connected multiple irrigation lines to some hoses that went out to my food forest. Each tree has a loop of this irrigation hose that circles the trunk, and each loop has 2 holes that allow a little bit of water to dribble out, which will keep the soil around each fruit tree damp. I'll probably still do a thorough manual watering from time to time at the hottest parts of the summer, but this extra water will make it more likely that my fruit trees will make it until I get out to water or until the rains come back in the fall. Now, I did run into some issues building this system. My trees are not planted at the exact same level. There's some elevation change. So when I first turned on the system, the trees at the lower areas were getting a lot more water, while the trees at the higher areas weren't getting any water at all. To ensure that all the trees got the same amount of water, I had to install some very inexpensive flow regulators, which allowed the entire length of the irrigation hose to pressurize and deliver the same amount of water to each tree at all elevations. Since then, the automated watering system has been running like a champ, and I can tell that my trees are enjoying the extra water and are putting on a lot of new growth. This was a relatively simple project, and I'm really happy with how it turned out. Well, with that, what's new with homeschooling?
Our kids, like most kids I know, love board games. And one of our recent favorites that we got for Christmas is Ticket to Ride. It gets selected a lot on pizza and game night. But I'll tell you what, It should have come with a spoiler alert, because when I first pulled out the insert and started reading it aloud, I almost ruined the ending of Around the World in 80 Days, which we are reading right now as our geography read aloud. Books about trips, travel memoirs, these are great ways to cover geography in a more engaging way. We have a world map where we've been tracking Phileas Fogg's progress as he circumnavigates the globe. And as of today, he is so close. He's made it all the way to Liverpool, so he's just a hop, skip, and a jump from London. Up until now, I would say stories have been the kid's favorite way to learn geography. But I may have topped it this term. The kids fell down a bit of a historical fashion rabbit hole recently, which led to the idea that for this term, instead of our usual map work, we would take this last term of the year and draw people in traditional dress by country. Our kids love drawing, probably more than any other activity, so anytime I work it into our schoolwork, enthusiasm goes through the roof. I've had kids asking if they can keep working on their pictures after school hours. It's been a lot of fun.
Well, with that, do you want to introduce today's discussion topic?
Sure. We mention in our intro that we seek to live a more natural lifestyle. So clearly we value the natural. Therefore, I thought an interesting topic to discuss would be the appeal to nature fallacy. This is the logical fallacy or false premise that something is good or right because it is natural, or conversely, something is bad or wrong because it is unnatural. The most common example given is that herbal medicines are more natural than modern medicine, but modern medicine is often more effective. I hesitate to use that example given the apocalyptic clown show that is our pharmaceutical industry, but it's obvious that natural doesn't always mean effective or good for you. For those suffering from seasonal depression, an all-natural remedy guaranteed to end all negative symptoms is hemlock, but I don't recommend it. Okay, so natural isn't guaranteed good, but I think the reason this fallacy is particularly interesting today is because it is a good rule of thumb. I think while historically movements away from nature were genuine improvements for the people's good, so many movements away from what's natural today is an exploitation for the sake of efficiency and maximizing profits. And when that is the primary value, it's not going to result in something natural or good.
You know, anytime I hear an argument being made for efficiency, I just assume the natural world is getting exploited in some way. The desire for super efficiency is what led to monocrop fields, high-capacity feedlots, ever-expanding landfills and sewer treatment plants, and the offshoring of American jobs to regions of the world with lower environmental and worker safety standards. When efficiency, when the profit motive, is the highest value, then everything else, concerns for the environment, the natural world, animal welfare, and the people, the workers, all those things come second. And not like a close second, but a very distant second. But getting back to the topic, the fallacy that says that which is natural is good. I found myself thinking about this the other week while I was out doing morning chores. You see, my grass is getting very long, and I have to be a lot more careful about where I step. The grass hides fire ant hills. The grass has chiggers. And I'm sure I'm going to come across a snake at some point. Recently, I found a big old turtle making its way across the pasture and fireflies dancing around at night. I'm often surprised at what I find out there, and I imagine that this was much more concerning for our ancient ancestors. I've been told that the ancient conception of nature was chaos. For the people of those times, the natural world was a place of disorder, a place of randomness. Nature was to be walled off and separated from the space that man built. Man imposed order and routine, and he sought refuge from what he did not fully understand or master. I find this view of nature so foreign. In our times, vacations are spent going to natural spaces. Ecotourism, an industry that's growing so incredibly fast, helps people access natural wonders in an effort to recharge and recenter themselves. And I find it funny that nearly all the motivational posters I remember seeing in the office would feature a waterfall or a mountain, a river delta, or the ocean. We seek to escape the chaotic, loud, and overwhelming human spaces for the peaceful, quiet, and tranquil natural spaces. Now, I love being outside. The homestead, camping, fishing, cooking over a fire, it's all wonderful. And I really like working on primitive skills, such as building shelters, setting traps for small game, and starting fires without matches or lighters. Yet I do not think that these primitive skills are a replacement for or superior to modern solutions. A tent, or really any shelter built with a plastic tarp, is better than my primitive shelter built of stones and sticks. A conibear snap trap or a wire snare is better than my traps built of stones and sticks. And starting a fire is so much easier with a lighter. But the source of satisfaction does not come from what is best or easiest, or even what is most efficient. I think that's why we seek out what is difficult, what is hard. I mean, sometimes it's fun putting in all the cheat codes and playing the game on God mode with all guns and infinite ammo. Yet, sometimes it's fun to play the game on its hardest settings, just to see how far I can get.
I do think there is a tendency to see ourselves differently than the rest of nature. More like that traditional view you described, James. Whereas we want to get back to the land and live in line with more natural rhythms, when talking about ourselves, there are baser instincts we need to rise above. Similar to how technological advancements have been used to overcome impediments from nature, self-discipline must be employed to overcome our natural inclinations. So I think there is less of a tendency to fall into the appeal to nature fallacy regarding ourselves. While we may put nature on a pedestal, so to speak, we tend to see ourselves as separate from nature, which has its own issue.
Well, that wraps us up for this week. Until next time, we'll keep taking the next steps in our pursuit of our higher ideals, and hope you're encouraged to take the next step towards yours.